Okay, hello and welcome to today's lecture for CS 303. Today we are going to be talking about contiguous memory allocation and paging. So this is CS 303, chapter number 8 and lecture number 3. So first topic for today is we'll finish up contiguous memory allocation. So we started our discussion on this in the last lecture. So we'll continue that and look at some of the memory allocation algorithms for CMA, contiguous memory allocation, and we'll do a bit of analysis on that. And then we will move on to one of the major topics of this chapter, which is paging. Okay. So contiguous memory allocation and paging. Okay, so these will be the contents of today's lecture. Okay, so now I am on slide 2. So if you recall, in the last lecture when we were discussing contiguous memory allocation, what is the main concept here? So main concept here is the memory that is allocated to a process, that memory is allocated as one single block. Okay, so which means we cannot have the scenario that for a particular process we have one block of memory, let's say between 100 and 200, and we have another block of memory between 300 and 400. Okay, so we need one block, so let's say 100 to 300. So whenever a process makes a demand for main memory, because obviously it has to the process needs to be in main memory to execute, so whenever a process makes a demand for main memory, we allocate one block of or one chunk of memory to that process, and we follow this concept for each and every process that we have. Okay, so the slide number 2 is from the previous lecture. So we see initially on the left hand side our memory is over committed, we don't have even one location available for even one byte of data. We have three processes, process 5, 8 and 2 besides the OS, right? So eventually process 8 either finishes execution or we decide to swap it out back to disk. So then that creates a large memory hole, vacancy, into which we first fill process 9 and then process 10. So you can see for each process, whether it's process 2, 9, 10, 5 or 8, we allocate one block of memory. Okay, so this is contiguous memory allocation. Okay, okay, now I am on slide number 3. And now we look at three algorithms that implement contiguous memory allocation for us. Okay, so the problem is very simple. How do we frame the problem? How to satisfy a request of size n from a list of free holes? So a process will make a request of a certain amount of memory, maybe 100k, 200k, 250k, 400k and so on, and that memory has to be allocated from the set of free holes. So we saw in the last slide, initially the whole of memory is one hole, at least the user part of it if we take away the kernel, and then so that is one hole. And then as we keep on allocating processes, and as time goes on, we have deallocation also. So eventually what our memory map looks like is a sequence. It has a set of memory holes and a set of process allocations, and they can be arranged in any fashion. So perhaps process 1 then hole, process 2 then hole and so on, or process 1 then process 2 then a large memory hole. So we can have an arrangement of these memory holes and these memory holes and process allocations in any sequence. So now we look at the algorithm. So now what do these say? First fit. So as the name suggests, allocate for a particular process request for memory, allocate the first memory hole that you encounter that fits, that is large enough, right? So obviously if you need 100k of memory and if the next hole is 80k, that will not be good enough, right? We need a memory hole of at least 100. So first fit, allocate the first hole that is big enough. Okay, so searching can start either at the beginning of the set of holes or at the location where the previous first fit search ended. So what you can have is you have a sequence of memory holes, and then to each memory hole you have a pointer, and then those pointers can be stored in, let's say, a linked list. Okay, so naturally you start looking for holes. So then each linked list could have different kinds of data stored in it. One could be a pointer to that particular memory hole, and the other piece of data could be the size of that memory hole, right? So you start your search either at the beginning of the set of holes or at the location where previous first fit search ended. So your first request, you start from the left, looking at one memory hole after the other. After, let's say, you essentially look at the first hole, that's not good enough, too small. Look at second hole, that's not good enough, too small. Look at third hole, that is good enough for the first process, you allocate. And now you do allocation for the second process, right? So here now you can again start at the beginning, because remember the first two holes were not large enough for process one, but they may be large enough for process two. Or what you can do is you can continue looking at from the fourth memory hole onwards. So both implementations are possible. Next we have best fit. So this is sort of an optimized algorithm. So here we allocate the smallest hole that is big enough. So if your request is for 98k and you have two holes available, one of 100k, one of 150k, which one do you pick? You pick the memory hole with 100k. So it looks like this is more optimized. You pick the smallest hole that is large enough to accommodate that process, right? So what is good about this algorithm? The nice thing about this algorithm is that your memory utilization within a particular hole is sort of maximized. Because for 98k, if you pick 100k, your utilization is almost 100%. But if you pick 150k, then it's not so high. There will be 52k of memory which will be wasted. Okay. So here we must search entire list. Right. So unlike a first fit, where as soon as you find a hole which is large enough, you allocate it. But in best fit, you have to look at the smallest hole that is large enough. So which means you have to examine all the holes before you can make a decision for a particular allocation of a process to a hole. Okay, so must search entire list unless the list is ordered by size. So one optimization you can do is you can sort the list by size, which means the smallest hole is at the beginning of the list and the largest hole is at the end of the list. And then you can search from left to right. So that optimization you can do. Advantage of this algorithm, produces the smallest leftover hole. So good memory utilization. Third one, sort of a counterintuitive one, is worst fit. So intuitively you may say, why would we go for something like worst fit, right? So let's see what the algorithm is. So this allocates the largest hole. So totally counter to the best fit, this one allocates the largest hole available. So again, once again, if you have 98k, which is the process size, and then you have two holes of 100k and 150k, Then which one do you allocate? You allocate 150k. So here again, you must search the entire list unless it is sorted by size. So I hope that is clear. What could be a reason to use this algorithm? The reason is this produces the largest leftover hole, which may be more useful than the smaller leftover holes from best fit. So if you are going to best fit, if your memory hole is 100k and your process is 98k, allocate. Now you have 2k. Now you have an option of using that 2k for allocating some other process. But the issue is that the size is so small that you will have a hard time finding a 2k process. Whereas if you had picked 150k, then what do you have left over? 150 minus 98, right? 52k. So it is quite likely, chances are high that you will find a process to fit into that hole. So one advantage of worst fit is it produces the largest leftover hole, and then whatever is left you can chop it out and then allocate to some other process. Holes produced by best fit, they may be too small to be useful. Of course, you can always do what we call defragmentation or coalescing, in which what you do is you take all the memory holes, small memory holes which may be there, and then you combine them together. But then that operation is costly because it means moving around of a lot of pointers. Okay, so these are the algorithms. First fit, allocate first hole that is large enough. Best fit, allocate the smallest hole that is large enough. Worst fit, allocate the largest hole. Okay. So now we'll do an example in which we see how these algorithms work. Okay, so now I am on slide number 4. And this is the sample problem. So which shows those three algorithms in action. So here we are given 5 memory partitions. The sizes are 100k, 500k, 200k, 300k and 600k. So here by 100k, I mean 100 kilobytes, 100 kb, right? 100 kilobytes. So 100 into 2 raised to 10 bytes, right? So 100 kilobyte, 500 kilobyte, 200 kilobyte, 300 kilobyte and 600 kilobyte in order. So this is how they are arranged. So you have you have a linked list, and each member of the linked list has a pointer to the hole. So first pointer is pointing to 100k, second to 500, third to 200, fourth to 300 and fifth to 600k. Okay, so that's the sequence. Now how would first fit, best fit and worst fit algorithms place processes of 212k, 417k, 112k and 426k again in order. So you have these requests coming one after the other. First for 212k, then for 417, then for 112, then for 426. Which algorithm makes the most efficient use of memory? So the best scenario would be, you have partitions of 100k, 500k, 200k. So your processes are also of the same size, 100, 500, 200. But in reality, that does not happen. You may not get an exact fit between holes and processes. Okay. So now we have to implement each of these algorithms and come up with mappings of a process to a memory hole. Okay. So if a process is allocated a memory hole, which means now that process can be brought into that memory hole. And now, we do the virtual address to physical address mapping one by one, right? Okay, so now let's see how each of these algorithms works. Okay, so now I am on slide number 5. We discuss the solution. So this is slide number 5. So memory blocks are from left to right, 100, 500, 200, 300 and 600. Processes are 212, 417, 112, 426. So let's look at first fit. So how does this algorithm work? Allocate the first hole that is large enough. So now we are at process 212k and hole 100k. So naturally 100k will not do. Next one is 500k. So this will work well. This is sufficiently large. So then 212k process is allotted to 500k memory block, memory hole. Okay, so remember first hole that is big enough. Next 417k. Now we can either start at 100 or we continue where we had left off. So we do the second option and we look at the next one, which is 200. So all we're doing is jumping from one node to the other in the linked list. So 200k, is it sufficient for 417k? No. Look at the next one, 300k. Is that sufficient for 417k process? No. Look at 600k, allocate that. So now we have done one pass through the memory holes. We can go back to the list beginning. 112k. Is 100k enough? No. 200k? Yes. And now look at 426k. Unfortunately, now there is no hole which is large enough for this. Only ones we had were 500 and 600, but both were allocated. Because here we don't have any kind of intelligence built in the algorithm. So therefore the first one we find that is large enough, we pick it. So 426k will have to wait till either 212k or 417k process finishes execution. Because then the memory hole can be released and can be allotted to 426k. Coming to best fit, allocate the smallest hole that is large enough. So 212k, so we scan, and the smallest one which is large enough is 300k. 417k, smallest which is large enough is 500k. 112k, 200k. 426k, 600k. So now, unlike in the previous case, we were able to find an appropriate memory hole for the 426k process. Okay. Last, looking at worst fit. So here you have to pick the largest, which of course can accommodate the process. So for 212 we pick 600, for 417 500, for 112 300, and for 426 we have nothing, because again 500 and 600 were available, were the ones which could have been assigned, but both have unfortunately already been allocated. So 426k again we'll have to wait, right? So in this way, we can do first fit, best fit and worst fit. So only with best fit that all of the processes were able to find memory blocks. So what is the issue if a process is not able to find a memory block? Well, the only issue is that process has to wait, right, till a suitable memory block is released, which sort of affects its finish time, response time, those kind of things, right? Okay, so I hope the working of the algorithm is clear. They are quite straightforward. Which of these has the best utilization? So utilization means that let's say we have a memory hole of 100k, and now if we are allocating a 98k process, so we have pretty good utilization. Only 2k is unutilized. Whereas if we put a process with 5k in the 100k hole, then how is our utilization? Our utilization is not good, because 95k is wasted. So among these three, which algorithm demonstrates the best memory utilization? Well, it has to be best fit, right? It allocates all of them and utilization is quite good. Okay, so utilization and worst fit will not be good at all. Of course, there is still an advantage to worst fit. The leftover hole can be used for allocating to other processes. But as far as memory utilization for the current allocation is concerned, worst fit will not be good. And likewise with first fit, because here again, it's sort of a first come, first serve. First one that is large enough, we pick that. So like you can see, 200K got allotted to 500K. So utilization is not that great. Worst fit, 212K allocated to 600K. Utilization is even worse. Best fit, 212K allotted to 300K. So best utilization. Okay. So now I am on slide 6. What about the performance of the three algorithms? So in terms of storage utilization, would be best for best fit, worst for worst fit, as the name suggests. First fit would be in between the two, as we just saw. In terms of the speed of the execution of the algorithm, naturally first fit would be better, because in would be faster, because in best fit and last fit, you have to best fit and the worst fit, you have to examine all the elements. Well, the other option you have is you can sort the list into increasing or decreasing order. Well, that also has a complexity. So in terms of speed, first fit would be better, right? Because the next appropriate one you find, you just allocate that. Whereas in best fit, you would have to look at all of them, unless they're sorted. If they're sorted, just look at the first and second and third. But again, sorting has a cost. So speed wise, first fit is better. So clearly you can see a trade-off between utilization and speed, which is going on here. Okay. Okay. Now we are on slide 7. Okay, so just now we talked about contiguous memory allocation. And here the main concept is for each and every process request for main memory, we allocate one and only one memory block or memory partition to each process. Okay. So, based on that, we looked at various kinds of memory allocation algorithms: first fit, best fit, and worst fit. Okay. So now we look at one of the issues with these contiguous memory allocation schemes. Okay, and that issue is called fragmentation. So what exactly is fragmentation? Let's look at that now. So initially, we discussed all of the memory. So here we are talking about main memory. Initially, all the main memory is one big contiguous hole, right? Whatever size. If you have 4 GB of RAM of main memory, you allocate 1 or 1.5 to the kernel. So what is left is 2.5 GB. So one big hole of 2.5 GB, right? Now, eventually a dynamic process at runtime, what happens is you have a series of memory allocations and a series of deallocations, which can be interspersed in any sequence. So one allocation, then a deallocation, then an allocation, then a deallocation, or, five allocations followed by four deallocations. Those sequence of allocations and deallocations can be in any order. This can be in any order, right? So eventually, what happens due to this is, we have holes of various sizes. So initially, holes of various sizes, and this can be a problem. Because what will happen is initially only one hole, and then you make some allocations, and then deallocation, and then some more allocations, and eventually your memory map looks something like what is shown in the picture here. So here what we have is the different colors, they signify that we have processes living there. So each color signifies that a particular process had been allocated that memory block. And then we have these gray blocks in between. So all these gray blocks, light gray blocks, are memory holes. Okay. So your memory map may look something like this. Now, if I add up all of these, the capacities of all of these memory holes, let's say I get something like 1900 kilobytes. Okay, and now I have process which has a requirement for 1000 kilobytes. Okay, 1000 KB. Right. Which sort of looks like 1 MB, right? So now, although the total amount of memory that I have is greater than 1000 KB, I have almost double that, little less than double. But the problem is that available memory is fragmented. So I have a hole of 500 K lying somewhere, another of 200 K lying somewhere else, another of 50 K, 2 K, 3 K. Lying at different locations in the memory, right? And note that I'm doing contiguous memory allocation. So we want to allocate one and only one block of memory to this process. So here in this scenario we cannot do that. So the situation is we have sufficient amount of available memory, but that memory is fragmented in different locations. So therefore, what this means is we cannot allocate memory to this 1000K process. It has to wait perhaps for the pink process to finish. Okay. So this picture has been taken from this website, dysphoria.net, some author's blog. Okay. So clearly you can see fragmentation is a problem. Right. So we can have a fragmentation can be of two kinds. One is called external fragmentation, which is external to a memory block, which is the kind we have here. We have a fragmentation among all these gray blocks, right? And then these are all external to blocks. It's external to a block. Okay. Fragmentation can also be internal to a block, and that we've already talked about. So let's say we have a hole of size 18,464 bytes. And we allocate a process of size 18,462 bytes to it. So now we have fragmentation within the block, 2-byte hole in that block. So we can have internal partition, internal fragmentation, which is internal to a block, because we may not get the exact fit between a process requirement and the block size. And we can have fragmentation which is external to blocks as well, which we see in this picture. So clearly fragmentation is a problem, right? Internal fragmentation is a problem because our memory utilization is not optimal. Okay. But perhaps we cannot avoid internal fragmentation. We can only limit it to an extent. External fragmentation is also a problem because we have the scenario in which we have sufficient amount of memory available to allot to a process, but because it's scattered, we cannot do the allocation under contiguous memory allocation. Okay, so clearly we see how this fragmentation can be a problem. Okay, so now I am on slide number 8. So how do we solve this fragmentation problem? Right. So fragmentation refers to building up of memory holes which individually are not of much use in allocation to processes. So how to solve this fragmentation? Solution one is compaction. So in the previous case, we had multiple memory holes, light gray memory holes, which were non-contiguous. One option is we can combine them together and create one block, one or maybe more than one blocks out of those. So that is compaction, and we can do that. So then eventually here we had in the previous case we had 1900K. So when we combine them together, that 1900K is enough to allocate to the 1000K process. So compaction, essentially it means sort of moving the memory holes around, right? So which means on one side we have all the processes, all of our allocations. And then perhaps on the right side of the memory map, we have the one memory hole. So note that this involves moving around all of these memory blocks, whether allocated or available. So this generally is an expensive operation, because depending on how many allocations you have, you may have to move a large number of memory holes around. So although this can be a solution, but it is because of the time it takes, it is generally not preferred a lot. Okay, it's an expensive operation. In the next slide, we'll see how we can do. So this compaction is also called defragmentation. So we'll see how Windows XP does this for disks. Right, but generally it's a slow operation. So we try to avoid it. A second solution, which is more interesting and looks better, is to permit the address space of a process to be non-contiguous. So remember, the problem in the previous case was if we add up all if we add up the memory holes, we get 1900k, but and our requirement is for a process of 1000k. But because of contiguous memory allocation, our assumption was all the memory, main memory allocated to the process with requirement 1000k has to be contiguous, and we did not have that. So how about we relax that assumption, which means we allow the memory allocation for a process to be non-contiguous. So we have one block, let's say of 500k, second block of 300k, third block of 200k, and all these three blocks are non-contiguous. So if we do that, then we can utilize our memory much better. So then even after this 1000k allocation, we still have 900k available. Okay, so this is the solution which is more preferred, in which we permit the address space of a process to be non-contiguous. So one block, so physical address space, one block in a particular set of locations, second non-contiguous, third non-contiguous. So this allows a process to be allocated physical memory wherever it is available. Okay, so the technique that achieves this is called paging. Okay, so now what we do is we relax the assumption that for a process we allocate only one contiguous block. So now we are allowing for non-contiguous memory allocation for each and every process. So this will eventually solve our fragmentation problem, because wherever memory is available, we will allocate it to a process. As long as we have even one byte of memory available, we can allocate it to the process that needs it. Okay, so here I am on slide 9, and this you may have seen. If you have a Windows system, you can check it out. This is from Windows XP. Assuming it should be there in Windows 10 as well. So Windows XP's disk defragmenter. So just like you can have fragmentation in main memory, right, due to the allocations and deallocations interspersed, right? In a similar way, disk is also a kind of memory. So you can have fragmentation in disk also. You take a process from disk, bring it to main memory, then again put it back to disk. So in the disk also you have these allocations and deallocations. Yeah. So eventually the disk can be defragmented also. Okay, so here it is showing the defragmentation tool for the disk. So the idea is simple. Try to put all the allocations together on one side, and then compact all the memory holes and try to put them together on the other side. And if you've had an experience for this, defragmenting takes a long time, primarily due to two reasons. First reason is you have to move around a large number of blocks, because you have a lot of processes. And second reason is here you're doing disk operations, which are anyway expensive. So if you may have done this, or if you do this in the future, you will observe that this can take anywhere from 2 minutes to 5-6 minutes and so on. So that's a very long time, and you may not want to do this very often. Okay, so a disk defragmenter for Windows XP. Okay, now I am on slide 10, and now we start our discussion on paging. So as we mentioned in the previous slide, one issue with contiguous memory allocation is that it leads to significant amount of external fragmentation. Fragmentation which is external to memory partitions or memory blocks. So partition is just another name for a block. Okay, so memory partition and memory block mean the same. So in order to avoid this external fragmentation, we now have the assumption that the address space of a process in physical memory, the physical address space of a process, can be non-contiguous. So in doing so, we prevent external fragmentation and lead to better memory utilization. Okay. So in this paging scheme, so now we know that we have a virtual address space, okay, of our disk. We have a physical address space of our physical or main memory. And we also know that each virtual address has to be mapped to a physical address before a particular process can be executed. So what we need is a mapping of a virtual address to physical address. So saying that for a process P, virtual address 1 maps to physical address A, virtual address 2 maps to physical address B, and so on. Right? And wherever we find memory in the main, in the physical memory, we allocate and we do the mapping. So once the mapping is there, then the process can execute, because now what it does is for every virtual address for a particular process, it figures out what the corresponding physical address is, and then that process instructions and data can be copied there, and then they can execute, because CPU can directly access the physical memory. It cannot directly access the disk. So here what we have is this physical memory is broken down into fixed size memory blocks called frames. So we take whatever physical memory we have, we decide on a particular size of a memory block, and each such block is called a frame. So obviously, so if we have 100k available and our frame size is 1k, so we have 100 of those blocks. And similarly, virtual memory is broken into blocks of the same size called pages. Okay. So once again, virtual memory is broken down into blocks of a particular size, and each block is called a page. Okay. Likewise, physical memory is also broken down into blocks, or is partitioned into blocks of the same size, which is called, each block is called a frame. So in the physical memory, you have a set of frames, and in the virtual memory, you have a set of pages. Now you have to allocate, you have to have a mapping between a page and a particular frame. Okay. So when a process is to be executed, its pages are loaded into any available memory frames. As we said, the virtual to physical mapping. So we say, okay, so fine, so there are 10 pages in this process, and these 10 pages are mapped to this and this physical frame. And then once we have the mapping, then we can load the pages into the frames, and now the instructions and data are there in those 10 physical frames. Now the process can execute. Okay, so once again, I'm repeating it, the disk is divided into fixed size blocks called pages that are of the same size as the frames in main memory. Okay, now I am on slide 11, and now we so as we discussed at the beginning of the chapter, all of these memory management solutions need support from the hardware. So what is the hardware needed for paging? So there is a paging hardware diagram on the next slide, which we will soon get to. But what we have here is each logical or virtual address So once again, virtual address and logical address mean the same thing. Just as physical and real address mean the same thing. So every logical or virtual address is divided into two parts. So you may have a 32-bit address. You can divide it into two parts, right? Maybe 20 bits in one, 12 in the other. The number of bits in each partition that can vary, as we'll soon see. So each virtual address is divided into two parts. One part gives us the page number, and the other part gives us a page offset. So this page number, this one part of the virtual address, this is used as an index into a data structure called a page table. Each process will have a page table, and what this page table contains is a list of base addresses for pages in the physical memory. Okay. Each entry in the page table is a base address of a page in the physical memory. Okay. So you know, each page will have a certain size and it will have a base address. So let's say starting from 100, 100 is a base address. And then from 100 you can get to 101, 102, 103, 104. These are all memory locations, and each memory location for each memory location we can have, you know, one byte of data. Okay, so if you want to access byte 1 within a page, you go to the base address 100. If you want to access byte 2, you go to the address 101. So just a movement of pointers. So each entry in this page table will have the base address of a particular page in physical memory. So you may not always want byte 1, you may want any arbitrary byte within that page that you want to access, right? So the granularity is such that you can access data and instructions at the level of one byte. Individual bytes can be accessed. So each memory location points to one byte, as we know. So now when you want to go to a specific byte within a page, when you want to access a specific byte within a page, for that you need the page offset. The offset value is added to the base address to define the actual physical address. Okay. So you have a base address. If you want the first byte, offset may be 0. If you want the offset has to be added to the base address. If you want a second byte, offset is 1, so you appropriately have to add, you have to attach that offset to the base address. So eventually the page number and the offset make up the physical address. Okay. So we have one picture here on the bottom which I have drawn. So two pictures actually, A and B. So in picture A, we are seeing a mapping between a virtual address and physical address. So we have a page in a disk which is mapped to a particular frame in the main memory. Size of the page and frame are exactly the same. Okay. And one observation you make is, note that the offset values for each pair of logical physical address are the same. So, you know, your virtual address will have an offset value, offset component. So, it will be more clear once we do some numerical examples. So, your virtual address will have an offset component, and likewise, your physical address will also have an offset component. And what we are saying is, the offset, both of these offset components will be exactly the same. So, why is that? So the answer can be found in picture B. So here you have a mapping between a page and a frame, and because their sizes are same, the number of blocks or number of slots will also be the same. So on the page we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have 5 divisions within a page, right? So 5 bytes, and frame also we have those same 5 divisions, 5 bytes. So we can say the size of the page as well as the size of the frame is 5 bytes. And we see that a byte 1 in the page corresponds to byte 1 in the frame. Byte 2 in the page corresponds to byte 2 in the frame. Byte 3 in the page corresponds to byte 3 in the frame. Byte 4 in the page corresponds to byte 4 in the frame. and byte 5 in the page corresponds to byte 5 in the frame. So offset is same. So if we have, you know, if we have offset of 0 in the page, we will have offset of 0 in the frame. It will be the first byte. If you have an offset of 1 in the page, we will have an offset of 1 in the frame. Offset 2 in the page, offset 2 in the frame. So the value of the offset will be same both for the virtual address as well as for the physical address. So which means we cannot have a scenario in which byte 1 of a page is corresponding to byte 5 of the frame. That is not allowed. Or byte 5 of a page is corresponding to byte 1 of a frame. It is not allowed. The correspondence has to be same. Okay. So what the process is, what we are doing is we have a virtual address. So the goal is to map a virtual address to a physical address, or to map a page to a frame. So what we have is, you know, the virtual address has two components. One is page number, one is offset, right? So we look at the page number and we use that page number as an index into the page table to get the base physical address. And the offsets are the same, and then we attach the offset, and then that way we can get the physical address. Okay. So now I am on slide 12, looking at the paging hardware. So again, our main goal is to map the virtual address to physical address. So of course, note that first we have to create the mapping. So let's assume that the mapping is already there. Later on, we'll figure out how to create it. So what we have here is we're given the virtual address, which has two parts, page number and offset. Offset, we know, tells us which byte we want to access within that page. Whether it's byte 0, byte 1, byte 2, we can address at the byte level. Okay. So two components, page number and offset for the logical or virtual address. We look at the page number, and that page number is used as an index into the page table. Okay, so whatever is the value of page number, if it's 100, then well, you go to the 100 cell and use it as an index. And then the entry in the page table for that index will contain the base physical address. Okay. Base physical address, which we get. So that now we have the base physical address, and we just attach the offset, which is the same. And then this F plus D combined gives us the physical address. So this is how we look up a physical address for a given virtual address. So we see the whole frame size here, F. And then within F, you know, we can go to individual bytes. These are the offsets, 0000 to 1111. So we can access individual bytes, right? So you can just imagine if the page size is 4k, 4 kilobytes, 4096 bytes, right? 4096 bytes. And you know, we have addressing up to a byte level, so we have, you know, we'll have 4096 parts of that, or chunks of that frame, each chunk addressing one byte. Okay. So this is the hardware given the virtual. So again, we'll do some numerical examples to, you know, make this really clear, right? So, but what we do here is, given the virtual address, we determine the page number and the offset. So page number will have, if it's a 32-bit virtual address, let's say for page number we have 20 bits, for the offset we have 12 bits. So we look up the page number, right? So the virtual address is made up of two components, page number and offset. So we get the page number, we use that as an index into the page table, and then now we look up the base physical address. Once we have that, then we just attach the offset. Offset does not change, as we said. because addressing byte 0 in page X would be same as addressing byte 0 in frame Y. Addressing byte 1 in frame W, addressing byte 1 in page W is similar to addressing byte 1 in frame X. So the page and frame, they can be different, but the offset is the same. Okay. So the value of P and F can be different, definitely. And mostly it is. But the offset D is the same. So then we know, F now we also know, we combine F and D and we get the actual physical address. And then we go to that address and then, we can do whatever we want. Run instructions, copy data and so on. Right. So in this way, we can, using the page table, we can look up corresponding physical address for a given virtual address. Okay.